the LWO was founded by the outside of the Irish Workers Group in April 1968 at a pub in Gray's Inn Road called the Lucas Arms. Mm-hmm. It was a remarkably dispirited gathering. Liam Dalton suggested a name, which was quite a good name.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think it was either assumed or formally agreed that I would liaise with Dublin, linked to mm-hmm. them. No, I certainly did it, whether I think it may have been agreed, I can't remember. But our differences developed right from the beginning. You know what the first difference was? Huh. On the Russian and its satellites' invasion of Czechoslovakia.
Oh, yes?
Yep. Paddy Healy came out in support of the Russians. I have a letter in our files where he says that. Now, I wrote a long letter in reply, which I haven't got a copy of. But certainly Paddy's letter is. And the argument was that socialism was being threatened, counter-revolution. Now, at the time I thought he was influenced by the Gerry-Healyites, because in the daily paper, in their paper, the twice weekly paper then, they raised twin slogans, no to Stalinism, no to capitalist restoration. Uh-huh. Now, even the Russians didn't allege that, although the Russians believed that the loss of political monopoly by the Communist Party would lead to that. And I discovered afterwards, I concluded, that Paddy was actually influenced by the BICO. Paddy Healy was more influenced by the BICO, you know, which had a
BICO, or was the ICO in those days?
Can't remember.
They were, it only be BICO about 71.
Yeah.
Anyway, they had a malign effect, mainly, you know, because they produced a lot of half-baked pamphlets, some of which had good stuff in them. And then, of course, they did one of those 180-degree turns. And scrapped half their pamphlets, mostly the ones with the best stuff in it.
That was much later, sir.
What?
That was much later.
Yeah, exactly. But they still had this. They impressed us all. I mean, because they
Impress me.
Well, simply quantitatively. I mean, I wanted us to write more. At last we were producing stuff, as you will have noticed. But it's a struggle. Money shortages. You can't do it. I don't know where the BICO got it. I don't know where the BICO got the money for all their pamphlets, especially as they have to change them every 10 years to change their line. I mean,
I think they make money partly by reprints. Some of them useful reprints as well.
Yeah, I know. I agree.
But what they were doing at that stage was they were reproducing either the ideas or the articles, mainly the ideas of third period Stalinism.
Yeah,
but on Czechoslovakia, they based themselves on Stalin's last great work, in quotation marks, the economic problems of socialism.
Yeah,
and he discussed the whole question of the monopoly. In any case, they, I concluded, influenced Paddy. So that was the first of us about letting people like you and Paul Gillespie, I remember you two, into the LWO. Paddy had a sort of, in Dublin, a lot of people came to Dublin because of tourists, revolutionary tourists, and that concept Paddy. And Paddy stopped being Paddy and he became a wee, you know, he would speak wee. But I mean, he successfully objected to letting people in. They made a ridiculous condition on you. I can't remember what I said about Gillespie. But it seemed the implications of that attitude was not that there would be some sort of regroupment, you know, a group broad enough to allow discussion, but that the little group would evolve on Paddy's axis. Mm. Now, that was a major dispute with us. We also had a dispute about the lack of activity. It was a big fight in 69 because they had a magazine, very infrequent and not very good. And Liam Dalton and myself spent about 2 weeks agitating in Dublin that they should start a more frequent publication, which they eventually did. I suspect Peter came to agree with us.
Mm-hmm.
So that was our other disagreement. And then what happened? The SLO. You know, they gravitated towards the SLL. At the time, the SLL was pretty crazy. And
softened was, up and softened up a number of young socialists to join the SLL or join the Workers' League.
No, I mean, a number of the younger LWR people, they drew the logical conclusion.
Mm.
They wanted to join the people they admired. Mm. And at the debate in Trinity, 70, July 70, I spoke as a pro or relatively pro USEC person, and a Healyite spoke. Now, I it was a gathering of lots of different Trotskyists, and what I remember is that we both, the Healyite and me, the Gerry-Healyites, spoke for very long, long periods, probably very boringly. And Paddy and Bashel and Carroll did not contribute to the discussion, no, you did. Until, towards the very end, Paddy made an announcement that they were not going to join. He may have said the leadership, but maybe that's just malice on my part, but that they, the leading group, were not going to join the Gerry-Healyites. Now, what happened there was that Peter Graham had put a gun to Paddy's head that if Paddy agreed to join the Gerry-Healyites, he, Peter, would split the group, organise a counter group and split it. Now, I don't know how much that influenced Paddy, but certainly Peter did it, and it was a pretty, you know, brave thing to do at that particular time, given Peter's circumstances. And anyway, Paddy was probably influenced by awareness that he wouldn't last long in a Gerry Healy type organisation. He would be bashed to smithereens.
Mm.
And so that was a real difference. And towards the end of 70, Liam Dalton and I told Paddy we were not going to work with them anymore, broken up relations. Now, I can't remember why, what triggered it. And if there had been some big issue, I would remember it. I think it was just that they did not learn the lessons of their flirtation with the Healyites.
Mm-hmm.
In fact,
probably
they were completely incorrigible.
Yeah.
And I didn't visit Dublin again until Peter's funeral. That was about a year later.
Yeah.
And then a sort of collaboration was re-established when one of them came to London. But I mean, essentially, they were incorrigible. And to a large extent, they functioned by not being political. You know, you couldn't talk the politics of the thing to Paddy.
Yeah.
Paddy would have
that was the thing. It all sort of, you know, Moses come down from the mountain sort of thing with Paddy, you know.
Yeah, but Paddy's fundamental. Now, Paddy had virtues. Paddy was solid, he kept things going. I was very impressed until the incident of supporting the Russian invasion. I thought he was a grown-up, then I ceased to be. But Paddy had no initiative, and he was politically absolutely wooden. You know, you couldn't say to him, look, this group has those and those and those characteristics. You shouldn't be friendly to them or want to join them.
Which is precisely the weakness, you know, the weakness on the national question, isn't it? I mean, there it was, the nationalism, bad, you know, any sort of approach on, on something that might be nationalism, bad.
I don't remember it as remotely as clear as that. I mean, I always thought there was an element of nationalism in Paddy.
Well, but possibly that possibly was suppressing it, or possibly that was the thing pushed by Coulter and Miller. I don't know. I mean,
I think that might be right.
But there was, as I told you, what you didn't hear was Paddy Healy going on and saying a true Trotskyist would rather die than do such a thing.
You can't remember what he said that about.
Well, he said it about quite a lot of things. And as somebody said, just wish he would do that and die. And sort of.
Well, this is after my connection.
But I know, Paddy. I mean, well, good. Paddy is producing useful work nowadays on figures, and he's rare. You know, really good. The statistics thing is really good, but overall, and analysis isn't too bad either. So we're sort of. Have a certain amount of rapport, more than we did in the 70s, certainly. Mm. More than we probably would have if I'd ever joined the LWR.
What what the LWR's evolution signifies to me indicates as a problem. It's the problem of intelligent people being politically very, very stupid. Yep. Now, we had an expression we used to have, based really on the experience of students. People made stupid by politics. Mm-hmm. You know, a student, instead of being open-minded, becomes dogmatic, rigid, doesn't really benefit very much from being a student. And in the case of Paddy, who was not stupid, and Basil, and Carol, who was very far from being stupid, mm-hmm. they were politically and unbelievably stupid. Mm-hmm. They were actually apolitical. They settled for a pseudo-international. Hmm. And they took their line from that. I mean, when was it, 1980, the Lambertists regrouped with others to form a new international link of the Marines.
I know. For 18 months, the largest international, apparently.
Right, yeah. Well, I mean, we were interested in the Marinists. Mm-hmm. So Martin and myself, we went to France. It was the only way to approach the Marinists. And I mean, the Lambertists we met were unbelievable, you know. I mean, there was one young man who was some official, and he would talk, and he would say the Fourth International. Every time he would say, founded by Leon Trotsky, you know, like a Muslim, Muhammad, praise be on his name and all that. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were, I'm getting off. It's very distressful, just to point. If you think about this, people who are not stupid, basically committing suicide. Can we discuss a bit more about Peter and Crimson?
Well, so this, as I say, I really...
Your lesson from that, what lesson do you draw?
About Peter? Don't...
The experience.
Oh. Well, sort of don't get too mixed up with urban guerrilla, with people who call themselves urban guerrillas would seem to be the obvious logic thing. Peter, as I say, was very much at first. If Johnny Morrissey was Lawless's protege, Peter was very much Paddy Healy's protege, very much. In fact, as I said to Paddy, the immediate aftermath of the murder, you know, this Paddy, you did bring Peter into revolutionary politics, and you know.
Peter differentiated from Paddy. Peter opposed the gravitation towards the Gerry-Healyites.
Well, Peter came to disagree. You know, was an independent thinker. He mightn't have Paddy's letters after, or any of the others' letters after his name, but he did. He thought for himself, but he was brought in, and in at the time of the IWG split, he was very much influenced by Paddy, and he'd been brought in to the IWG, rescued from Stalinism by Paddy. You know, I mean, there was no doubt. I mean, I was trying to, I had little or no, as I say. I presume the general feeling was that I was the centrist playing and would sort of drop out in.
You believe that Brendan Corrish would lead us wherever we wanted to go. That was a quotation from, I think, your friend Bob Mitchell.
Bob was a bit more social democratic than I was, and he prospered to a certain extent. He was mayor of Wakefield.
What?
You know, Bob was mayor of Wakefield at the turn of the millennium.
What, in England?
In Wakefield, yeah, up the road, yeah.
Did he?
Yeah. Oh, yes. He's survived. He was out of...
Labour mayor.
He was so disgusted with New Labour, he left it, but he's since rejoined and joined Momentum. But anyway, that's his background. He's still there. There's a picture...
He joined Momentum?
Yeah. You know, what would you do? I mean, he's left Social Democratic, mainly because the... Well, he doesn't believe in small organisations, you know. I mean, he's given up on this sort of thing.
Well, I thought of Bob as a real social democrat. You know, we had a falling out because he wrote something about the Fenians, absolutely rejecting everything specific to them. A real social democratic nonsense.
Well,
but I mean, it's a shame, really. But look, you say the lesson is keep away from urban guerrillas. Well, there might be situations where you would not keep away. The point about, that, to my mind, The point is that the impressionism of the USEC led not just... That did not lead Peter. Peter was had a different trajectory. It led people like you to have delusions about Sarah.
Well, it wasn't... No, it wasn't simply... I mean, they were there. They were not the stickies, which were already sort of very much in an iron grip.
Yeah, what they were doing made no sense, and they did nothing but robbery.
Well, that is the point. The point is that was not so apparent. They were robbing. We thought they were. If they could be brought back, they were participating, for example, in the Irish Civil Liberties League, which I found was getting, you know, increasingly bogged down. You know, there was this body, but they were, you know, they were not. We were not getting anywhere with it. But you know, there were people there who were open to politics, and then I think that now, knowing what I now know, there could have been possibilities. I was raw, you know. I was raw. I was green. And I couldn't do it, so that's... And also, of course, I was Mayfane Amon.
Well, I mean, I think Peter's experience and Peter's summary of his experience, it wasn't the final summary, but his conclusion, you couldn't talk to him. Now, I spoke to them, to a group of them, and I think Liam Dalton would have been with me, about a dozen or more of them, and arguing about politics, and they couldn't combine politics with what they were doing. And I remember the arguments. Look, we are not withdrawing from the Irish Workingness Movement. When there's a strike, for example, we'll go down and use our force and so on. But it was all utter nonsense. Have you read Paul Williams' book on gangsters, Badfellas?
No.
Yeah, have you?
I have not.
Yeah, but I mean, he gives he pulls together the facts about Saor Éire. And he says they, in fact, tried to support a strike, and they were rejected completely. You know, supporting a strike in the sense of, I think they drove off lorries or something. But I mean, it never made any sense, and I doubt very much if any of them could have been won politically. The traffic was the other way around, you know.
Yeah, well, it certainly turned out they
had a number of young socialist people involved in military training, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I won't name names, but I mean, they had the advantage of us because the logic of what they did was total. You know, you couldn't just rob a bank now and again.
Right? You robbed a car on the run, yeah.
That's a terrible, terrible business. Again, in terms of the facts of the history, the LWR we set up in April, 68, wasn't just an Irish affair. There was a London branch.
And it would have been Liam Boyle, wouldn't it?
Liam Boyle was in it, Christy Hussey was in it, Liam Dalton, and there must have been others, I can't remember. Joe Quinn, maybe?
Quite possibly Joe Quinn. I don't know if, though I don't know that he would have lasted very long. I mean, I knew it sort of met. I only met Joe later on.
He was a quite close to Dalton.
I think he was too. Mind you, I mean, you know, just as if we may have been on the other side, I got on quite well with old Liam too, so not just amazingly enough. I mean, I was one of the last people to see him alive, I suppose.
But all right, we had a London group. And the London group took charge of producing a printed paper.
Mm-hmm.
And they produced two issues of Workers' Republic, two printed issues. And then the group collapsed, basically. Christy went back to Ireland, I think. Liam went off, I don't know where he went, I can't remember. And Dalton was never, you know, a steady man to do things. You know.
That was his,
You couldn't expect him to do it.
No.
But, then the thing simply became Dublin, and then Paddy was the pillar. Paddy kept it going.
Yeah. Why we would be, yeah.
Yeah, and I mean,
much better organiser than I was. Yeah, I'm sorry. Much better organiser than I was. I mean, what he organised may not have been so great, but he organised.